Hear the words of Scripture from the prophet Jeremiah, 31st chapter, verses 31 through 34. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. It will not be like the covenant that I made with their ancestors when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, a covenant that they broke, though I was their husband, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law within them and will write it on their hearts. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. I don't know a lot of you. I know some of you. And I appreciate the opportunity to be here today. My understanding is that Pastor Dwayne had some other obligations this week. So he spent a lot of time and thought and prayer about who the best person to preach today would be. And he called that guy, and he had other obligations too. And so after he finally worked his way down the list, he got to me. So we'll see if we can make the best of it. Let's pray. Now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts together be found acceptable in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. When we read the passage that we read just a moment ago, there's an odd conclusion to it, and I think we overlook it. See, we read this passage this time of year as we're coming to the end of Lent and preparing for Easter, and we read the words about the new covenant, the coming of the day of the Lord, and we focus on that. We read that text with a combination of joy and anticipation. Joy because we know that in Christ's death and resurrection that we proclaim at Easter, that act becomes the central turning point in God's story of reconciliation with the world. And anticipation because we know that God's work is not yet done. And we look forward to the day when it's completed. But there's more here. I want you to listen to this last verse again. No longer shall they teach one another or say to each other, "Know the Lord," for they shall all know me, from the least of them to the greatest, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. Listen to that connection. No longer shall they teach one another, for they shall all know me, for I will forgive their iniquity and remember their sin no more. See, what this tells us is the way that we know God most fully is in God's forgiveness. And so we're right to read this passage at this time of year as we get ready for Easter. Because in Christ's life and death and resurrection, we most fully experience God's forgiveness. That great and gracious act of salvation. And that's why we come here, year after year, week after week. It's why the church has been gathered together throughout the centuries and around the world to proclaim that good news. See, we read throughout Scripture about God's forgiveness over and over again. God vows throughout the Old Testament to destroy his people. And time again, he forgives them. God shows mercy. Think about the examples. Noah, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Moses, David. All stories of human failure. And divine forgiveness. On a larger scale, we read the stories of the judges and the kings. And time again, the people forsake God. And time again, God promises to destroy them. And time again, he doesn't. He forgives them. He shows mercy. And we read in those stories about a people who are described much like Jeremiah does today. A people who are described as God's bride and God is the groom. And we read about these people who are unfaithful over and over again. They're distracted by every flirtation. And God promises to destroy them, but he doesn't. He saves at least a remnant of the people over and over again. And we come to the New Testament, and we read about Peter, who constantly puts his foot in his mouth, who oversteps his bounds, who's too eager when he needs to be patient, and who, when it really counts, denies Jesus not once, not twice, but three times in one night. But Jesus still doesn't reject him. Jesus calls him back into the fold, forgives him. We read about Paul, who spends his time traveling from city to city looking for Christians to kill them. And we read about a God who calls even him and forgives him. And even when we get to the book of Revelation, that story of the final day of the Lord, what we find is in large part a story of forgiveness, of God calling the church to return to him. And we come to church week after week, and we hear about God's forgiveness, and that makes perfect sense. Especially in light of the passage that we read today. The divine forgiveness that we experience, or at least the divine forgiveness that we're offered, even if we don't fully experience it, is beyond explanation. It's one of the great mysteries of our faith. And yet, strangely enough, it's this profound forgiveness that we often have the least amount of difficulty with. See, God's forgiveness is abstract to us. We are so physically and intellectually and emotionally removed from God that often when we think about divine forgiveness, it's just an intellectual exercise. That's why God calls us into community. This is why, as Scripture tells us, and as Pastor Dwayne has reminded us over these last few weeks, that we as the church are the body of Christ, the physical presence of God in the world. And so, what I want to propose today is that just as Jeremiah tells us, we know God through God's forgiveness. But I want to go a step farther. I want to propose that all acts of forgiveness are in some sense divine acts. This is why the Gospels tell us over and over again that if we forgive others, God will forgive us. See, every time two people are reconciled to one another, God's grace breaks into the world. In that moment when those two sisters, those two neighbors, or even those two strangers forgive one another, they reveal God to each other. In that moment when one person extends their hand in forgiveness to the other, they both come to know God more fully. That's why we pray, when we pray the Lord's Prayer, for God to forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And so, in many ways, in a very real sense, when we forgive those who have wronged us, we're actually able to experience God's forgiveness more fully in our own lives. We come to know God, not in the abstract, but in the relational way that we know one another. And that's why the Bible isn't just a story about God's forgiveness of human beings, but also about human forgiveness granted to one another. See, the Bible is also a story about Jacob, who steals his brother's birthright, but is still forgiven. It's why the Bible is also the story of Joseph, whose brothers sell him into slavery, convince their father that he's dead, but they're still forgiven. And when the time comes, not only does Joseph forgive them, but he saves them from certain starvation. Scripture is the story of neighbors being reconciled to one another, of enemies being turned into friends. It's the story of social and economic and political and religious differences, of gender, of race, of class, all being overcome through God's act of reconciliation. And this is why, when Scripture describes that day of the Lord, the picture that it paints is one of complete reconciliation, so that even the lion and the lamb lie down together. So while I think we ought to forgive other people because God has forgiven us, I don't think we only forgive other people because God has forgiven us. We also forgive others because in doing so, we experience God's grace coming into our broken world. In forgiven and being forgiven by other people, we come to know God. For we can never truly experience God's grace when we are unwilling to extend forgiveness to those who have wronged us. And while God's forgiveness of us is by far the most profound forgiveness that we could ever experience, our forgiveness of one another is often more tangible to us. See, it's easy for me to say, oh, God's forgiven me, for you to say, oh, God's forgiven you. It's far more difficult for us to live out that forgiveness in our everyday lives. I want to close with a story. Many of you have probably read this story or heard this story. But even if you have, I want you to bear with me for just a minute. This is a story of Corrie ten Boom. She was a young woman living in the Netherlands in 1940 when the Nazis invaded. And over the next several years, she and her family helped hundreds of Jews escape the Holocaust. But in 1944, she and her entire family were arrested, and they were shipped off to the concentration camps. Her father and her sister both died in the camps. But after the war was over, Corrie spent the rest of her life traveling the world proclaiming God's forgiveness. In the days after the war, she established a ministry helping victims of the concentration camps be reintegrated into society, but alongside them, helping those who had collaborated with the Nazis. Listen to her words about one of her experiences. It was in a church in Munich that I saw him. A balding, heavy-set man in a gray overcoat, a brown felt hat clutched between his hands. People were filing out of the basement where I had just spoken, moving along the rows of wooden chairs to the door at the rear. That's when I saw him, working his way forward against the others. One moment I saw the overcoat and the brown hat. The next, a blue uniform and a visored cap with its skull and crossbones. It came back with a rush, the huge room with its harsh lights, the pathetic pile of dresses and shoes in the center of the room, the shame of walking naked past that man. Betsy and I had been arrested for concealing Jews in our home during the Nazi occupation of Holland. This man had been a guard at Ravensbrück concentration camp where we were sent. Now he was in front of me, hand thrust out. A fine message, Fräulein. How good it is to know, as you say, all of our sins are at the bottom of the sea. And I, who had spoken so glibly of forgiveness, fumbled in my pocketbook rather than take his hand. He would not remember me, of course. How could he remember one prisoner among those thousands of women? But I remembered him, and the leather crop swinging from his belt. I was face to face with one of my captors, and my blood seemed to freeze. You mentioned Ravensbrück in your talk, he was saying. I was a guard there. But since that time, I have become a Christian. I know that God has forgiven me for the cruel things that I did there, but I would like to hear it from your lips as well. Fräulein, again, the hand came out. Will you forgive me? And I stood there. I, whose sins had again and again been forgiven and could not forgive, Betsy had died there. Could he erase her slow, terrible death just by asking? It couldn't have been many seconds that he stood there, hand held out, but to me it seemed as hours as I wrestled with the most difficult thing I had ever had to do. For I had to do it. I knew that. The message that God forgives has a prior condition, that we forgive those who have injured us. If you do not forgive men their trespasses, Jesus says, neither will your Father in heaven forgive your trespasses. And I stood there with coldness clutching my heart. But forgiveness is not an emotion. I knew that. Forgiveness is an act of the will, and the will can function regardless of the temperature of the heart. And so woodenly, mechanically, I thrust my hand into the one stretched out to me. And as I did, an incredible thing took place. The current started at my shoulder, raced down my arm, and sprang into our joined hands. And then this healing warmth seemed to flood my whole being. I forgive you, brother, I cried, with all my heart. For a long moment, we grasped each other's hands, the former guard and the former prisoner. I had never known God's love so intensely as I did then. See, it's in forgiveness that we know God. And God is constantly calling us to know him more fully. God is constantly stretching out his hand to meet ours, calling us to embrace his forgiveness, but also to extend our own hands to those around us. So as we prepare to leave here today, I invite you to consider that call. Could it be that the forgiveness that you grant someone in your life allows you the grace to more fully know God? It could be your husband or your wife standing next to you, a brother or sister, a son, daughter, your mom or your dad. It might be a friend or a coworker, a neighbor. We know God and God's forgiveness. And in the coming days, we will proclaim the forgiveness that we experience through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. But today, I invite you to stretch out your hand to those around you, to offer your forgiveness, and in so doing, to embrace the grace of God that comes through that forgiveness. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.